If there's an anti-hero in the New Testament, or at least among the disciples, it's probably Thomas. I mean, nobody wants to be Thomas. He's the Rodney Dangerfield of the disciples. In fact, if you read the list of the disciples, Thomas is always in the middle, sandwiched between those above him and below him. He's somebody that just goes unnoticed. And when we do notice Thomas, we just notice the negative things. In fact, that's why Thomas has gotten the adjective doubting Thomas, right? And who among us would like to be known as the doubter? I mean, just think of that. Put your name in. Put the adjective doubting Dwayne. That has a ring to it, doesn't it? Doubting Dwayne, or put your own name in. I mean, none of us wants, but this morning I want to suggest that Thomas sometimes gets a bum rap. In fact, most of what we know about Thomas is from John's Gospel. The other Gospels have him in list of disciples and maybe a couple of passing references, but most of it comes from John's Gospel, and it comes in three places. It comes in the 11th chapter of John's Gospel, it comes in the 14th chapter, we hear about Thomas, and it comes in the 20th chapter of John's Gospel passage that we just read. And I think there are some interesting insights if we were to go to those. You can follow along if you want. But in the 11th chapter, Jesus wants to return to Lazarus, right? Lazarus had died. The disciples aren't getting it. And there's a lot of heat around Lazarus. In fact, Jesus offended a lot of the rulers and leaders when he's been in that part of the country. So he's going back into dangerous country. And I sense that the disciples really don't want to go, but Thomas says, let us go. Let us go. Now he's displaying a level of courage there, isn't he? The other disciples aren't saying anything, but Thomas says, let's go. I mean, he's dedicated to the Lord, and so he's not all bad. It's positive. And then in the 14th chapter of John's Gospel, that's the passage where John says, I'm building a mansion for you. If I go, I will not leave you alone. And in the course of that dialogue, Jesus says, you know the way where I am going. And Thomas says, no, we don't know the way. Well, at first blush, you go, wow, that's not the best thing. But many of us know questions need to be asked. How many of us have been in a classroom or are teachers, and everybody has a question, but all of them are afraid to ask it? You ever been there? And so a teacher will teach a whole thing, and then they'll go, well, we didn't understand it way back then. Well, why didn't you ask? Well, I didn't want to be. Well, Thomas at least asks, doesn't he? He says, we don't know. We don't know. And so he raised that. And in today's passage, I mean, the disciples say, Thomas, here, Jesus is raised from the dead. And Thomas says, well, unless I can touch it and see it, that I'm not going to believe. I mean, we should believe on evidence, shouldn't we? Nothing wrong with that. And then when Jesus finally does show up, Thomas at least reverses his position. He says, my Lord and my God. How many people do you know, even in the face of evidence, they won't change their perspective? Maybe you're married to one of them this morning. You know what I'm talking about? Yeah, you said that real loudly, Vicky. Be careful now. You were thinking somebody else. I know you were, right, Vicky? So Thomas isn't all bad. And maybe doubt really isn't the issue. Maybe he gets a bum rap. I want to suggest this morning that maybe there's something here that's more spiritually dangerous than doubt. I mean, doubt can be a part of faith. I believe faith is bigger than doubt. Doubt makes us ask questions. A faith that can't handle questions isn't a faith worth having, folks. It really isn't. In fact, cult leaders, that's often what they cultivate, isn't it? Don't ask any questions. Just swallow it all, hook, line, and sinker. So I think faith is bigger than doubt. In fact, one of the things that does me pleasure, don't do it today because I'm really tired and I won't be able to respond. But one of the things that does me great pleasure is after church folks draw scripture and say, Pastor, what about this scripture? What were you thinking there? I like to be challenged in that way. So I think doubt is bigger than faith. And I think in today's passage, the question isn't so much doubt. I think that there's something much more insidious going on here. Perhaps there's something more insidious in Thomas that we often miss or dismiss in ourselves and others. So what is that? I think if we go back to those passages that are mentioned, I think we start to get a glimpse of it. Remember that passage in John 11? They want to go back to Lazarus. And Thomas, at least, he's courageous, and he goes, let us go, right? And then right after that, he says, so that we may die with him. Kind of a bummer, isn't it? Is Thomas maybe a bit fatalistic? Is he maybe kind of on the negative side? Well, let's just go. It's a done deal. We might as well just go and die. I think we see the same mindset reinforced in the 14th chapter of John's Gospel. Remember Jesus saying, you know the way where I'm going? And Thomas says, we do not know. And then he adds this question. How can we know the way? Maybe a little bit of negativity there, a little bit of pessimism. Maybe he's going something like, you haven't told us, Lord. How can you expect that? You have such high expectations for us. How do you expect us to know that? And then doesn't all this pessimism really rear its ugly head in today's passage? Think of it this way. Thomas doesn't believe the fellow disciples. He unequivocally says, until I see Jesus' wounds and touch them with my own hands, I won't believe you. Thomas is simply saying no to what seemed to him an impossibility. He's a pessimist. He's so negative in his thinking that there is no way that someone could ever be alive. He's ruled it out carte blanche from the start. And I suspect that's why he's so shocked when Jesus shows up. My Lord, my God, wow, this was, whoa. Now I want to suggest this morning that that's was at stake. And that's why I want to start a campaign. Everybody's running for office campaign. I mean, Bill Hall back there, look at him.
Everybody looks at Bill.
I want to start a campaign this morning that we rename Thomas from Doubting Thomas to Dark Thomas. And here's why I want to rename Thomas. Here's why I want to rename Thomas. Thomas's problem isn't doubt. It's darkness of the soul. It's that attitude of heart that always chooses to focus on the negative and the gloomy. And here's the problem when you have a darkness of soul. You're being presumptuous with God. Because you look at the world and you see nothing but negativity out there, and you say, in effect, God, I know you can't do that. I know it from the get-go. And when it comes to the future, you go, God, I know you can't do that. I know it already. It's a lack of trust, isn't it? When you have that kind of darkness in you, it's a lack of trust. And I suspect Thomas has that kind of darkness, and I suspect many of us struggle with it. I mentioned it last week. It's called Eeyore Christians. The sun's out. Oh, boy, I wish it was raining. It's raining. Oh, boy, I wish the sun was out. Do you know anybody like that? Are you married? Don't you answer. Maybe it's a relative, a mother, or a father. How many of us know somebody like that? In our present political climate, it's all around us, isn't it? So much cynicism, so much skepticism, so many people assuming that we're going from bad to worse. It's all around us. And we as Christians, we got to keep our feet firmly grounded, or it's like a deluge, and it'll just sweep us along. In fact, if you want to experience, just watch the nightly news on one of those 24/7 programs. I bet you if you watch it straight through for about 24 hours, at the end, you'll be a very dark person. It's all around us, and so we have to be on guard against it. And we personally have to be on guard against it, because I don't know about you, but I struggle with that darkness. I struggle with it. I just finished a whole project. Forever. And whenever you do a home project, you know what you discover? You know where all the mistakes are. Don't you, Hans? You know where every mistake is. And when I go to that project that I finished, I find my eye going to that mistake. Oh, Jesus. Oh, why did you do that? It just naturally happens to us, doesn't it? Shouldn't surprise us. We're sinful creatures. But we have a tendency to focus on the negative. And so I think that pull is in your life and my life. It was in the life of Thomas. We all have that tendency to focus and see that the the glass is empty, half empty. And here's the scary part. If we stay there, listen to me. If we stay there, if we cultivate this negative mindset, if we always assume the worst, it starts to infect our whole selves. It becomes a part of our personalities. You know somebody who has a dark personality? Man, you can pray for them. They can be a brother and sister in the Lord, but you want to hang out with them? Or maybe it's somebody you know and somebody else is married to them, and you go, wow, I'm sure glad I'm not married to that person. I'd kill them. You know what I mean? I'm speaking the truth, aren't I? It's like what scientists call a black hole. You know, a black hole absorbs everything, and even light itself can't get out of that. When we become dark and black in the spirit, when we become just so negative, it's like Christ's light can't even get out of it. And oh yeah, we can proclaim the gospel, we can know the Apostles' Creed, we can have all our beliefs, but somebody starts interacting with us and they feel that, and they say, wow, if that's what it means to follow Jesus, you can have him. You talk a good game, but I don't sense it in your spirit. I don't sense it in your spirit. And it's a vicious downward cycle, folks. It's vicious. How many of us have ever heard of the placebo effect? It's been proven, right? If people are thinking what the medicine they're getting, it has healing capabilities, it tends to oftentimes produce healing, even if it's a sugar pill. The way we think, the way we look at the world has an incredible impact on what occurs in our life. How about a self-fulfilling prophecy? It's been proven. They did one study of some college students, and it was a random, so they had men and women. So they told like five guys who randomly picked that this attractive girl liked them, and they told the other five that she didn't like them. And then they allowed them to interact, and then they interviewed them after. And you know, those who thought they liked her, she tended to like them a lot better. And they tended to believe that she really did like them. And vice versa. It has an effect, right? It has an effect. Let me get the term correctly. It was a study. It's one of the classic studies of this. The Pygmalion effect. How many of us remember that from our education courses? Right? They went in and randomly took students and went to the teachers unbeknownst to them and said, these students, even though they weren't, are your best students, they're your rising students, they're your upper level students. The teacher didn't know it. And then at the end of the year, you know which students were up there? Those that the teacher assumed, right? It has an effect. It has an effect on our lives. When I was in the restaurant business, they used to say something like this. If you have one dissatisfied customer, they'll go out and tell 10 others. You have one satisfied customer, they'll go out and say one other customer. See, we focus on the negative. That's the sinful nature. And the world around us loves to focus on it. And they invite us to be a part of it. We, as followers of Jesus Christ, of all people, death does not have the last word. We remain hopeful. We see the world through the light of Jesus Christ. I told this funeral about Robin's mother-in-law, this story of Robin's mother-in-law's funeral just this last week, but I think it captures it so well. Many of us are familiar with this story. Ronald Reagan loved to tell it. It's about a 12-year-old girl who wanted a pony with all she begged her parents for months on end. It was her 12th birthday. She woke up at the crack of dawn and ran to the barn, and she threw open the barn doors. And in the dim light, all she could see was manure. And she said, with all that manure, I know there's a pony in there. With all that manure, I know there's a pony. What with the manure of life, you focus on the manure, and it gets all over us, doesn't it? Or do you say, as a follower of Jesus Christ, there is a pony in there. I know there's a pony in there. Thomas was somebody who focused on the manure. Vicious if we get in that cycle. That's why Paul said, Whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if there's anything praiseworthy or excellent, dwell on those things. Sit on them. Keep reminding yourself of them, because this darkness world around us is full of manure and it's going to get all over you. But if you dwell on those things, you'll always know that there's a pony out there. There's a pony out there. And Jesus himself was so concerned about that. In his first sermon, as Matthew tells it, the Sermon on the Mount, there's a passage that we often overlook, but it like jumped out at me as I was preparing my message for today. It's in the 6th chapter of Matthew. Jesus says these words. He says, "The eye is the lamp of the body, so if your eye is healthy, your whole body will be full of light. But if your eye is unhealthy, your whole body will be full of darkness. If then the light in you is darkness, how great is the darkness?" That's my question to us today. What do you see? Does light come out? Or do you see nothing but darkness? And if it is dark, how dark is it? Because you're in dangerous spiritual territory. You're dangerously wandering far from the true light who came into the world so that you and I might have life and have it abundantly. So, simple question. Where are you? What kind of Christian you are with the adjective? Are you a dark Christian? A negative Christian? Or are you a Christian of the light, a positive Christian? Which are you? Are you willing to ask yourself that question? Willing to ask God to reveal it to me? How about this? Are you willing to ask those people around you and accept the answer and repent? Are you willing to say, "Hon, am I a little on the negative side? Do I tend to be focused on always the glass being empty?" And when you accept the answer and change, work to change, because it really is an act of the Spirit that changes us from that. You just can't mentally. You've got to begin to envision it mentally, but then you've got to allow the Holy Spirit, because he is the only one. Folks, if you put your hope in anything else, you're going to end up dark and black and negative. But you put your hope in Jesus Christ, if he does the changing, oh man, I have so much hope in my life. I don't care what happens in this political. I don't care if the whole world goes to hell in a handbasket. I've got Jesus Christ, and in the end, God wins.
Amen.
God wins. So what sort of Christian are you and me? What sort of Christian? Are we positive because we know the risen Savior? We focus. We're allowing those voices in our heads, the demons, we all have them, or because we're allowing those voices in the world around us to just drag us down. Let's pray. Gracious and loving Lord, help us to help us to be children of the light in a world of darkness. Indeed, that's what you call us to be. Help our hearts to be filled with hope because we know you. We know the power of your resurrection, and indeed we believe that you've been raised from the dead, Lord. Help those of us who struggle with the negative to be infused through your Holy Spirit to be more positive. Help all of us, because we all need an infusion of your Spirit to overcome the darkness that's all around us and that we too often find within us. So, Lord, we're simply confessing that we need you, and we pray that you would help us and this church to be a place of light. And we pray all this in Jesus' most precious name.